Well, good morning, everyone. Happy Easter. It's great to see every one of you this morning. He is risen this morning. Amen? Amen. Isn't it exciting we get to celebrate? Should be this excited every day. Let's start this Easter Sunday by raising and lifting His name on high. Would you stand if you're able and sing with us? Lord, I lift Your name on high. Lord, I lift Your name on high. Lord, I love to sing Your praises. I'm so glad You're in my life. I'm so glad You came to save us. You came from heaven. You came from heaven to earth to show the way from the earth to the cross, my debt to pay. From the cross to the grave, from the grave to the sky. Lord, I lift Your name on high. Lord, I lift Your name. Lord, I lift Your name on high. Lord, I love to sing Your praises. I'm so glad You're in my life. I'm so glad You came to save us. You came from heaven. You came from heaven to earth to show the way from the earth to the cross, my debt to pay. From the cross to the grave, from the grave to the sky. Lord, I lift Your name on high. You came from heaven to earth to show the way from the earth to the cross, my debt to pay. From the cross to the grave, from the grave to the sky. Lord, I lift Your name on high. Now, if you feel comfortable, let's go around and let's say hi to someone this morning. We got a lot of new faces. Wave at them, shake your hand, whatever you feel comfortable. Amen. Now, before we watch our Annie Armstrong video, I know that you're saying hi to people around you. But because it's an Easter Sunday and we have a lot of people here that maybe wouldn't normally be here, maybe some friends and family, does anyone want to introduce any guests that they have with them? No pressure if you don't want to, but I know our time is short to get to say hi to everyone. So would anyone like to introduce someone that they maybe didn't get to meet? We're good? Okay, I just wanted to offer it. Sometimes you got your whole family here and you want to show them off because they're looking good and they're happy and you got new something, who knows? But I wanted to share that. Here we have a video real quick before we sing.
Como pareja decidimos que lo mejor era salir de ahí.
Tenemos hace 3 años que llegamos aquí a Canadá. Nosotros somos una familia de 5 personas y les dije que veníamos de vacaciones porque tenía miedo que mis hijos adolescentes, al saber que nos íbamos a venir a otro país, a otro lugar, pues no quisieran venir y se fueran a otro lado, se escaparan.
We were introduced to a Mexican family, and this Mexican family was interested in learning more about the gospel, learning more about the Bible, and that's actually how we started this church.
Desde el momento en el que él empezó a leernos la palabra de Dios, el Espíritu Santo llegó a mi corazón en ese momento que yo dije, me gusta, quiero. Y para mí, cuando me preguntaron que si yo quería bautizarme, no lo pensé porque yo estaba segura. Pero después de mi yerno y mi marido fueron al mismo tiempo. Y después ya mi hija.
En México, mi familia ya estaba muy separada. Entonces no íbamos a la iglesia, nada. Y más que nada nos hizo muy, muy, muy bien acercarnos a Dios.
Nunca me imaginé el estar aquí como estoy ahorita, platicando acerca de Jesús. Pero hemos cambiado muchas cosas. Todo lo que somos, todo lo que hacemos es por obra de Dios, por su bondad, por su gracia.
Everything we are, everything we do is because of God and His grace and mercy. Amen? Wow, that's powerful this morning. Hallelujah, Christ arose. Stand with me again if you can. Let's sing together. Christ the Lord is risen today. Alleluia. Sons of men and angels say, Alleluia. Raise your joys and triumphs high. Alleluia. Sing ye heavens and earth reply. Alleluia. Love's redeeming work is done. Alleluia. Fought the fight, the battle won. Alleluia. Death in vain forbids him rise. Alleluia. Christ hath opened paradise. Alleluia. Soar we now where Christ has led. Alleluia. Following our exalted head. Alleluia. Made like him we rise. Alleluia. Ours the cross, the grave, the skies. Alleluia. Lo, in the grave he lay, Jesus my Savior, waiting the coming day, Jesus my Lord. Up from the grave he arose, with a mighty triumph o'er his foes. He arose a victor from the dark domain, and he lives forever with his saints to reign. He arose, hallelujah, Christ arose. Vainly they watch his bed, Jesus my Savior. Vainly they seal the dead, Jesus my Lord. Up from the grave he arose, with a mighty triumph o'er his foes. He arose a victor from the dark domain, and he lives forever with his saints to reign. He arose, hallelujah, Christ arose. Death cannot keep his prey, Jesus my Savior. He tore the bars away, Jesus my Lord. Up from the grave he arose, with a mighty triumph o'er his foes. He arose a victor from the dark domain, and he lives forever with his saints to reign. He arose, hallelujah, Christ arose. Amen. I serve a risen Savior, He's in the world today. I know that He is living, whatever man may say. I see His hand of mercy, I hear His voice of cheer. And just the time I need Him, He's always near. He lives, He lives, Christ Jesus lives today. He walks with me and talks with me along life's narrow way. He lives, He lives, salvation to impart. You ask me how I know He lives. He lives within my heart. In all the world around me, I see His loving care. And though my heart grows weary, I never will despair. I know that He is leading through all the stormy blast. The day of His appearing will come at last. He lives, He lives, Christ Jesus lives today. He walks with me and talks with me along life's narrow way. He lives, He lives, salvation to impart. You ask me how I know He lives. He lives within my heart. Rejoice, rejoice, O Christian, lift up your voice and sing. Eternal hallelujahs to Jesus Christ the King. The hope of all who seek Him, the help of all who find. None other is so loving, so good and kind. He lives, Christ Jesus lives today. He walks with me and talks with me along life's narrow way. He lives, salvation to impart. You ask me how I know He lives. He lives within my heart. The moon and stars, they wept. The moon and stars, they wept. The morning sun was dead. The Savior of the world was fallen. His body on the cross, His blood poured out for us. The weight of every curse upon Him. One final breath He gave, as heaven looked away, the Son of God was laid in darkness. A battle in the grave, the war on death was waged, the power of hell forever broken. And the ground began to shake, the stone was rolled away. His perfect love could not be overcome. Now death, where is your sting? Our resurrected King has rendered you defeated. Forever He is glorified. Forever He is lifted high. Forever He is risen. He is alive. He is alive. The ground began. On the ground began to shake. The stone was rolled away. His perfect love could not be overcome. Now death, where is your sting? Our resurrected King has rendered you defeated. Forever He is glorified. Forever He is lifted high. Forever He is risen. He is alive. He is alive. Sing forever. Forever He is glorified. Forever He is lifted high. Forever He is risen. He is alive. He is alive. We sing hallelujah. We sing hallelujah. We sing hallelujah. We sing hallelujah. The Lamb has overcome. We sing hallelujah. We sing hallelujah. We sing hallelujah. The Lamb has overcome. We sing hallelujah. We sing hallelujah. We sing hallelujah. The Lamb has overcome. We sing hallelujah. We sing hallelujah. We sing hallelujah. The Lamb has overcome. Forever He is glorified. Forever He is lifted high. Forever He is risen. He is alive. He is alive.
We're going to sing that one more time. Forever. Raise your voice to Him this morning.
Forever He is glorified. Forever He is lifted high. Forever He is risen. He is alive. He is alive.
Father God, I thank You that we can sing that truth this morning, Father God. That the story didn't end on Friday. It didn't end on Saturday and what I'm sure seemed like, who knows. Father God, I saw a post yesterday that said Saturday is a great example of the silence and not an answer at this time, at this time to a prayer doesn't mean that you're not going to work. And I thank You for that this morning. Father God, that in a world that we have so many questions and so many of us are dealing with so much that's going on, Father God, that yes, there was a Saturday and yes, there was a Friday where we were feeling that, where everyone that was a believer at that time, Father God, was feeling that sorrow and that emptiness, Father God, but Sunday was coming. And I thank You for that resurrection and for that hope and for that glorious appearance of our great God and our Savior Jesus Christ as He rose. Help us in our hearts to be prepared this morning, Father, to the joy and the excitement that You have for us in a life following Jesus Christ. Dying to ourselves, Father God, just as Christ died on a cross so that our lives that are full of sin that we don't want anything more with can now be eternal because of Jesus Christ on the cross. We give You praise, and as we sang this morning, hallelujah, He is alive. In Your name we pray. Amen.
Well, we're going to continue on in a time of prayer this morning. We've got a couple of prayer requests that I have here. First one, we just want to pray for Stacy's mom, Wayna. She is been placed into hospice house, and they think she may have sepsis, so she is not doing well. Just want to be in prayer for her, be in prayer for the family as they're just trying to figure out what's the best course of action, what do they need to be doing, and how best to make her comfortable and just kind of deal with that situation. So we just want to be in prayer for the Lott family. And then Joyce Woodring is going to have a second estate hearing coming up, I think, this week. And so we just want to be in prayer for her and for that situation. Just be prayer for that the Lord's will be done and that they can work out the legal issues that are going on there. I also want to be in prayer for the Weedle family. Carol Weedle passed away this last week. I just want to be in prayer for her family and as they're grieving, but also know that she is in heaven. So we want to be rejoiceful, but also, you know, just be in prayer for the family as they are grieving the loss of Carol. Does anybody have any other prayer requests we need to? All right. We'll just take a few minutes to pray where you are, and then I will close out here in just a minute. Let's pray.
Peace and comfort and just that they would know the way they should go, Lord, and they would be able to follow your will and your guidance. Lord, we lift up Joyce and her court hearing. Lord, I pray that you just be with her, be with her attorneys and those that are involved with this situation. Lord, I pray that you just would work it to your will, that you would just guide and lead those that are making decisions, Lord, that they would just follow your will, follow the path that you have for them. With them, Lord. We lift up Carol's family as they mourn and grieve. Lord, I pray that you just would comfort them, let them know that they are not alone in this, that we are with them, that you are with them, Lord, that they are loved, that they are supported, and that Carol's with you in heaven, and that we should rejoice and be glad in that, even as we are sad that she has left us here. Lord, I just pray that you just speak to us this morning, that we would be open to the message you have for us, Lord, that Brother Ben would share from your words and your heart, Lord, that the message that he shares, we would just hear it, Lord, we'd be present. Just really take to heart those words you have for each of us. Lord, we just pray that you just continue to help us to be good stewards of those gifts that you've given us, that we would take the tithes and offerings that are given, and we would use those in accordance with your will, and to further your kingdom. Jesus.
Simple words repeated. Give me Jesus. Give me Jesus. You can have all this work. Give me. In the morning when I rise, in the morning when I rise, in the morning when I rise, give me Jesus, give me Jesus, give me Jesus, you can have all this world. Give me Jesus.
When I am alone, when I am alone, when I am alone, give me Jesus. Give me Jesus. Give me Jesus. You can have all this world. Just give me Jesus. When I come to die, when I come to die, oh, when I come to die, give me Jesus. Give me Jesus. Give me Jesus. You can have all. Give me Jesus. Give me Jesus. You can have all this world. Give me Jesus.
Amen. Amen. That was so beautiful. Thank you, Levi. Thank you, Ben. You know, it's been said down through the centuries that Christians die well. That's because we have the peace of Christ and the hope of Christ, that this life is not all there is, that we, when we are absent from the body, the Bible says we're present with Christ. Amen. All right, it's great to see such a big crowd here this morning. Awesome, extended family and guests, so welcome. I woke up this morning and I just had just a joy. There's just a tangible joy that I feel every Easter Sunday morning. It's just so real. I went to a Bible conference, a preaching conference 2 weeks ago, and the guest speaker was Dr. Erwin Lutzer. And he said this to us. He said, "I've never heard a sermon that I didn't get something out of it. But," he added, "I've had some really close calls." So, I pray this morning, my prayer this morning is that you don't have a really close call, that you're going to be able to get some things out of this message. And and it's about the resurrection. The title of my message this morning, it's coming up there. The case for the resurrection. If you were to make a case for the resurrection, what would you look at? And before we get into those things, I want to tell you that every year there's a place in the Italian Alps. The Alps are not just in Switzerland, they're in Italy also, that there are the Stations of the Cross. And some people go up in those mountains, thousands of people every year, and they go walk past the Stations of the Cross. And then they usually come and stand finally at a crucifix there. And there was a tourist there that was there one day, and he noticed that beyond the crucifix there was a small little path, and he decided to explore it. So he went through some weeds and some brambles and got there, and he realized it was a little garden area dedicated to the empty tomb. You know, so many people, they come to the cross, but then they fail to go on to the empty tomb. We can preach the cross, and the cross is essential to our salvation, but we must go on to the Easter message. We must not stop there at the cross, because when Jesus laid down his life on the cross, I was going to say killed, but basically he laid down his life on the cross for us, and he was placed in the empty tomb. 3 days later, he arose. And he is alive forevermore. And I love those songs that we sang, because I remember singing those as a child. And this morning, that song was in my head. He arose. He arose. And so we have to go beyond to find the message of salvation, the message that Jesus Christ is a living Savior today in the world to aid us, to walk with us through every situation that we're in. And so sometimes we get stuck on a Friday, and problems are bad. And we just see all around us despair and hopelessness. It looks like death has won. It looks to the followers, the disciples of Jesus at that time, it looks like the Jewish leaders had won. Saturday, God was silent. Like he said, even when God is silent, it doesn't mean he's not working. Oh, hallelujah. But there came a Sunday morning, hallelujah. And Jesus triumphed. And came out of that grave. The angel rolled back the stone to let the disciples in. The ladies in. The disciples came and looked and saw that it was empty. And everybody was running and telling everybody. And we're going to get to that in just a little bit. But they understood that Jesus Christ was alive. And Paul talks about he highlights the significance of the resurrection. Because the resurrection is so important. He said this. For if Christ is not risen, your faith is futile. You are still in your sins. Then also those who have fallen asleep in Christ have perished. If in this life only we have hope in Christ, we are of all men the most pitiful. But now Christ is risen from the dead and has become the first fruits of those who have fallen asleep. So let me just say, what can we, if you were to make a case like a lawyer, what would you say gives evidence of the empty tomb? How can we authentically look at Scripture and accept the reality of the resurrection? I'm going to tell you there's seven things we're going to look at today. Now, before we do that, let me just tell you that this Bible that I have is not just a holy book. It is. It's not just a spiritual book, a supernatural book, a religious book. It is all of those things. But it's also an accurate historical book. So the things that we're going to look at today are also historical events, because everything in the Bible here, when we look at people, places, events, cities, it's all been corroborated by archaeologists and historians. It is a record of God's working in civilization. And so it's not just some far-out book. There are some religious books that have these mythical deities and these, you know, strange characters and all of that. This is grounded in history. This is God's story of interacting with mankind. Let's go ahead and read our text this morning, Mark 16, verses 1 through 7. Now, when the Sabbath was passed, it means Sunday morning early, Mary Magdalene, Mary the mother of James, and Salome bought spices that they might come and anoint him. Very early in the morning, on the first day of the week, they came to the tomb when the sun had risen. Now, Joseph of Arimathea and also Nicodemus had already laid him in there and put some spices, but the ladies knew that the guys probably didn't do it just right, okay? And they were going to come and add the finishing touches. And they said among themselves, "Who will roll away the stone from the door of the tomb for us?" But when they looked up, they saw that the stone had been rolled away, for it was very large. And I'm going to look at that in just a minute. That the Greek there reads that it was exceedingly super large. Okay, those are the Greek words. And entering the tomb, they saw a young man clothed in a long white robe. I bet that's an angel, huh? Sitting on the right side, and they were alarmed. But he said to them, "Do not be alarmed. You seek Jesus of Nazareth, who was crucified. He is risen. He is not here. See the place where they laid him. But go, tell his disciples and Peter that he is going before you into Galilee. There you will see him as he said to you." Join me in a word of prayer, please. Father God, we ask that your blessing would be upon this message this morning, and the reality of the resurrection would just become much more real to us as we look at the events and the historical things that happened surrounding the death, the burial, and the resurrection of Christ. And so, Lord, speak to every heart. And if there are people today that don't know you, Jesus, as their Lord and Savior, I pray that they would accept you and they would call upon you to come into their lives and be their Savior, whether they're here in person or whether they're watching on social media this morning. And I pray all of this in the holy name of Jesus. Amen. Now, on the Marys, by the way, Mary was a very popular name. And we had Mary Magdalene. We had Mary, the mother of James, which was also the son of Alphaeus, and Salome. And she was the mother of James and John, the sons of thunder. So when we look in Mark's account, we're going to look at the stone this morning. The first thing I want you to look at is the stone. It was a very, very large stone. As I said, in the Greek, it meant it was exceedingly super large. Now, it was described in some manuscripts as a stone that was so large that 20 men could not carry it away. In the ancient world, people were, or at that time, were not generally buried in the ground, but they were buried in kind of like caves, or they would carve a sepulcher, what they called, out of a hillside, out of the limestone. We might have a picture of something like that here. It was something about like that. And I have never been to Israel, but people said that if you go there today, you can see what they think might have been the very tomb that Jesus was laid in. And so that it was secured by a very large stone that could have maybe even been larger than this. And it had a groove there. And when after they put the body in, the stone was rolled down to the lowest point. And then it was going to take a lot of men, probably with levers, to roll it back. And it could have even been larger than this, because Joseph of Arimathea, it was his tomb, and he was a very rich man, so he might have said, "I'm going to make this the biggest and best ever." We don't know. But usually the opening was about 4 to 5 feet, something like that, 4 to 5 feet tall. And we know that when James and John, John and Peter ran to the tomb, they had to stoop down to look inside. And so there was a wedge that held it there. And then again, the stone prevented anyone from violating the contents that were within. Now, there has been some studies about how much a stone like this would weigh. And we don't really know, but they've had conservative calculations. And some have said that a stone that's big enough to cover an opening like this, that might be 6 feet tall, 5.5 to 6 feet tall, probably weighed somewhere around 1.5 to 2 tons. So it was a very, very large stone. And that's why the women were going, "We can't move it. We don't know who is going to be able to move this stone for us. Maybe we can find a group of men or something like that." It's also interesting when it talks about the stone that John uses a word which in the Greek, which means to pick up something and carry it away. So it would seem when we look at the Gospel of John that the stone was just kind of not rolled back, but it had been taken away from its normal position and thrown out somewhere in front of the tomb, the empty tomb. So anyway, the removal of a stone was a remarkable task, especially since the women came there first and they were the first to report that Jesus was gone. They didn't know where he was. And then the angels appeared, and it's kind of like, I don't know, everybody started running everywhere, telling everybody, and Jesus was appearing to various ones, to the women on the road, to Mary Magdalene, to the disciples that evening, to the disciples on the road, two disciples on the road to Emmaus. And so we know that there are 10 recorded post-resurrection appearances of the Lord Jesus Christ. We also have a record of the soldiers. The soldiers were posted there. A guard was posted there in Matthew 27, verse 62 through 66. We're going to read about this. On the next day, which followed the day of preparation, the chief priests and the Pharisees gathered together to Pilate, saying, "Sir, we remember while he was still alive how that deceiver said," I shudder every time I look at that, read that word, "after 3 days I will rise. Therefore command that the tomb be made secure until the third day, lest his disciples come by night and steal him away and say to the people, he is risen from the dead, so the last deception will be worse than the first." Pilate said to them, "You have a guard." We imagine it was a Roman guard. "Go your way, make it as secure as you know how." So they went and made the tomb secure, sealing the stone and setting the guard. The Jewish leaders were panicking. Thousands of people were following Jesus. They had heard Jesus say, "Destroy this temple, and in 3 days I will build it up or raise it up again." And he also told his disciples very plainly. They didn't quite grasp it. It seems like they were a little dull. But he said, 3 days, I'm going to rise. I'm going to come alive again. So they went again, as we just read. They went to Pilate and said, "We need a guard. We need a guard because we know what he said." And so a Roman guard usually consisted of 4 to 16 men. And they were trained to kind of defend about a 6-foot area. And because there were about, you know, we know 12 disciples at first, Judas Iscariot, of course, went out and hung himself. So there were 11 at that time. But they said, "We need to have a guard." And so probably they had 16 or even 20 soldiers there. We know that they didn't want to leave anything to chance. They wanted to make sure they had enough manpower there of the soldiers so they could defend this tomb. And so every 4 hours, they had a shift of the watches. And so every 4 hours, different soldiers, some would sleep, some would watch during the night. They would always have soldiers that were awake and protecting the tomb or defending the tomb, because to fall asleep or to not protect what you had been assigned to protect as a guard, as a soldier, was punishable by death. So you didn't mess around. You were very sure to keep guard and do that vigilantly. So they had these soldiers around, and there is a theory that the disciples stole the body, which is what they told them to, you know, to tell people. But that's really absurd, because I'm going to explain that in just a little bit. But why would they want to do that? Why would they even want to do that? So there was a very large guard there to defend the tomb. So we had to, you have to come up with, how did Jesus get out of the tomb? How did the disciples and the ladies look into the tomb with the guard and the large stone there? Well, we're going to have an answer here in just a minute. I did wonder this. I never had this thought before, but I wondered about the guards, you know, what they were thinking. Like, you know, he did say he was going to rise in 3 days. And I bet there were some of them going, "Don't worry about it. It's just a fable or something. Don't worry about it. Just be cool, okay?" I bet they were a little nervous, like, "But what if, don't worry about it. Just, we got a job to do. We're just going to stay here." And so they were probably a little edgy, okay? I was just wondering. And then when they sealed the tomb, what they would do is they would take a cord and they would stretch it across that stone that sealed the tomb, that round stone, and they would fasten that cord on either end with sealing clay. And then they would have a signet from Pilate, the governor, and they would stamp it. And if anyone broke that seal, it was a death sentence. So they had the seal. Now, on resurrection morning, that seal was broken. We have in Matthew 28, 2 through 4, this is how it was broken. And behold, there was a great earthquake, for an angel of the Lord descended from heaven and came and rolled back the stone from the door and sat on it. And his countenance was like lightning, okay? He was like, the Shekinah glory was shining from him. And his clothes as white as snow. And the guards shook for fear of him and became like dead men. They were just scared out of their wits. They just like, you know, they just, it says they shook. And that word is kind of a word they use that's almost for like an earthquake. It's similar to the word that the Bible used for an earthquake. So they began to tremble, and then they evidently passed out. They became like dead men. And I wondered, when the angel came down, every time you read the Bible, you have a new thought. And I thought, I used to think that he was just kind of like abracadabra, like the angel comes down and then just kind of goes like that, you know, and the stone just rolls away. But it says it was picked up. John's word is something that means to pick up. And so I had a funny thought that the angel just came and the soldiers are looking at him and he's glowing in all the glory of God. He just takes it up, puts it on his shoulder, walks out, looks at the guys, throws it down, sits on it, looks at them. They're like, we need a bigger boat. We need a bigger guard. It wasn't going to happen. They were just scared out of their wits. When we also look at the sepulcher, which is an interesting word, but it's the tomb, we find that it was not actually completely empty, because the Bible says that there were grave clothes that were there. Grave clothes. In fact, they were there laying on where Jesus was laid, but they were not disturbed. They were just kind of like caved in. Usually they put a cloth around Jesus, a long cloth in the front and the back, and then they would wrap him kind of like a mummy. They would wrap him and put different spices and things in there to preserve the body, and they would wrap him up. And it says that when they looked in, the grave clothes were there, and the napkin that they had put around his head was neatly folded and placed there by where his head was. In fact, we look at that in Luke 24, 1 through 3. Now on the first day of the week, very early in the morning, they and certain other women with them came to the tomb bringing the spices which they had prepared. But they found the stone rolled away from the tomb. Then they went in and did not find the body of the Lord Jesus. That's what I did. That's what. And then it says further on that they found the grave clothes just lying there. They went in and found the grave clothes just lying there. Another theory is this. Some people have said, okay, the body disappeared, but that it was the Romans, or it was the Jews that stole Jesus' body, that they removed it so that the disciples couldn't steal it, which is really totally absurd, because had they really had the body, whether the Jews had it or the Romans had it, they could not have, when the disciples started going, he is risen, he is risen, all they would have had to do was to get the body of Jesus and say, guys, he's not risen. We have the body right here. So the Romans or the Jews could have extinguished Christianity in its cradle, basically, because they would have had the body of Jesus. So the theory that the authorities took it makes no sense at all. Makes no sense at all. Did the disciples steal the body? Others have said, no, the disciples somehow managed to fight off the guard, etc., and they stole the body. Why would they do that? Well, there's really no reason, because to preach Jesus and to follow Jesus was to be persecuted. And we know, according to extra-biblical accounts, that every disciple, except for the Apostle John, was martyred because they would not stop preaching that Jesus Christ is alive, that he was resurrected. There are 8 sermons recorded in the book of Acts by Peter, by Peter, Stephen, and Paul. And in each of those 8 sermons that we find in the book of Acts, we find that the central theme is the resurrection of Jesus Christ. It was the central theme in those messages. So the disciples went out everywhere and they started preaching about Jesus, and they would not be quiet. They would not shut up. And you know, people may, well, let me just say this. If you knew something was definitely a lie, would you die for that lie? No, you wouldn't die for that lie. You would say, you know, hey guys, it's really, don't kill me because it's just a lie. We stole the body, etc. But when you knew that Jesus was alive, you would say, I have no other choice. I am telling you the truth. You can kill me if you wish, but Jesus Christ is the Lord and Savior of the world. Also, let's go to John 20 and look at the shroud. John 20, 3 through 8. Then Peter went out, and the other disciples were going to the tomb. And I kind of combined 2 verses, but we're going there. So that they both ran together, and the other disciple outran Peter and came to the tomb first. And he stooping down and looking in, saw the linen cloths lying there, yet he did not go in. Then Simon Peter came following him and went into the tomb, and he saw the linen cloths lying there and the handkerchief that had been around his head, not lying with the linen cloths, but folded together in a place by itself. Then the other disciple who came in the tomb first went in also, and he saw and believed. Again, going back to the empty tomb, it was empty, and the only thing was there were the grave clothes. Now, the grave clothes are very interesting, because had the body been actually stolen, who would take time to unwrap all the grave clothes? Nobody. You would want to get in, get the body as fast as possible, and just get out of there so you wouldn't be discovered. Also, there's a theory that Jesus just kind of fainted, okay? The swoon theory. And the swoon theory says that he fainted, and then after 3 days with no food, no water, no medical attention, he came alive again. He rolled away the stone. He fought off the Roman guard, and then he presented himself triumphantly to his disciples, to his followers, which is really absurd. So the swoon theory makes no sense at all. So the fact that the grave clothes were there really eliminates the theory that the body was stolen. It also eliminates the fact that Jesus resuscitated himself. The only way that you could have those grave clothes like they were in the empty tomb is that the body went right through the grave clothes. And we know that Jesus had that ability, because it says when the disciples were gathered together that he, even though the door was closed and locked, he just walked in the room. So Jesus could, his body could go through, it was not, let me say this, it was not limited to the physical realm. It could just pass through a wall, it could pass through grave clothes, it could pass through anything. And so Jesus came back and his body was alive. We know that he took the thief that had been on the cross. There was 2 thieves, and we know that one believed in him, and he said, today you will be with me in paradise. Okay, you will be with me in paradise. And so he came back and rose up his physical body, and it says he's been the first fruits of those who are asleep. It means that when you and I go to a funeral and we go to the graveyard and we lay our dearly beloved loved one in the grave, if they know Jesus Christ, this is not their final resting place. It's just a temporary resting place. Their spirit has ascended into heaven. But one day, in the twinkling of an eye, and don't ask me exactly how it happens, but with God all things are possible, the body and the spirit come together and the body is glorified to live forevermore. That's how it happens at the rapture, at the great and general resurrection. Amen. We also have the scars. A new thought I had about the scars. There is another theory. I hate to keep bringing up theories, but there's another theory that there was an imposter, a lookalike, okay, a stand-in. And that stand-in was crucified, but it wasn't really Jesus because Jesus was hiding out. And then after that lookalike was crucified, then Jesus, who was in hiding, comes out and said, "I'm alive. I'm alive." You know what blows that up? The scars in his hand. He said, "I am the same Jesus that you saw hanging on the cross. I'm that very same Jesus." And it's a very interesting thing that we know that Jesus appeared to the disciples without Thomas the very first evening of the resurrection. And then later on with Thomas. We have a record here in John 20, 24 through 29. Now Thomas, called the twin, he had a twin, one of the 12, was not with him when Jesus came. That's the first time. Then the other disciples therefore said to him, "We have seen the Lord." So he said to them, "Unless I see in his hands the print of the nails and put my finger into the print of the nails and put my hand into his side, I will not believe." Talk about hard-headed. If you have 10 of your closest friends telling you something and saying, no, really. I mean, he was with these guys for 3.5 years. And they're like, "Thomas, he was here. The ladies have seen him. Others have seen him. I mean, he was here, right here." And he's going, "Nope, don't buy it, guys." Yeah, wow. Anyway, hard-headed. He must have been from Missouri or something, all right? And after 8 days, his disciples were inside again, and Thomas with them, and Jesus came, the doors being shut, and stood in the midst and said, "Peace to you." Then he said to Thomas, and he looked right at Thomas. It's like, "Man, you're pretty sad, you know what I mean?" And then he looked at Thomas, then he said to Thomas, "Reach your finger here and look at my hands, and reach your hand here and put it into my side. Do not be unbelieving, but believing." Do you think the Lord ever hears you when, you know, you don't know if he hears you or not? He hears you. He knew what he said. And so a lot of times you're talking, and if you're praying, you just know that God knows exactly what you said. Jesus knows exactly what you're praying. And Thomas, and I'm sure he was very ashamed, answered and said to him, "My Lord, my God." You know, Jesus said to him, "Thomas, because you have seen me, you have believed. Blessed are those who have not seen and yet have believed." I love that verse because that's me and you. That's who we are today. That goes to us. We have believed, we have not seen him, but we believe because of so many things from the scripture and other experiences and from changed lives. God has changed my life. I know he's changed your life. He changes lives. He gives us new beginnings. And won't get into all that. And then we have the sightings. We have the sightings. And Paul kind of paraphrases. He doesn't include all the sightings. But in 1 Corinthians 15, 3 through 8, he says this, "For I deliver to you first of all that which I also received, that Christ died for our sins according to the scriptures." Some of the Jews didn't realize that. He had to die for you and me. He had to. "And that he was buried and that he rose again the third day according to the scriptures, as he said he would. And that he was seen by Cephas or Peter, then by the 12. But after that he was seen by over 500 brethren at once, of whom the greater part remain to the present." This was written about AD 54. So most of those people, many of the 500 were still alive. But some have fallen asleep. "And after that, he was seen by James, and then by all the apostles," including Thomas. "And then last of all, he was seen by me also," which was on the road to Damascus, "as by one born out of due time." So he starts putting that all together. I believe that when he was seen by the 500, it was probably in a mountain in Galilee where he gave the Great Commission. And I believe that that's where that happened. So many of those people were still alive. And, you know, if you took 500 people and gave them each 6 minutes to testify of seeing the risen Lord, you would have over 50 hours of testimony that attested to the fact that Jesus was alive. And here's the interesting thing. You know, Jesus didn't just appear to one or two people. And it wasn't like one or two people had this crazy story, like, I saw some dark, shadowy figure over there. I think it was Jesus. Or I had a mystical dream. No. Jesus showed himself at various places, at various times, to individuals, to groups. I mean, he showed himself to believers. Interesting. He never showed himself to any of the unbelievers. In this world today, we say, if I see it, I believe it. But the Bible says you have to have faith. I believe it, and you will see it. If you believe, you will see because of the evidence. Faith is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen. And so, again, as I said, there were 10 recorded appearances, actually more than that if you throw in the appearances that the Lord made to Paul. Some say 12 or 13 post-resurrection appearances. So let me just go over this one more time with you. The reason that we believe from Scripture, not including our own testimonies and the testimonies of others that we have known, it's because of the stone, this immense stone. How was it moved? Because of the soldiers. How were they overcome? How did Jesus get out of the tomb? Really, you know this. I'm just going to tell you again, though. The angel didn't roll away the stone to let Jesus out. Jesus was already out. They just rolled away the stone so his followers could look inside. Also, the seal, which could not be removed by penalty of death. The sepulcher itself was empty. The shroud was there in the empty tomb. The scars on Jesus' hand, and then the sightings. And also, to me, the most compelling thing is the fact that the disciples would not be quiet. They went everywhere telling people that Jesus is alive. Jesus is alive. Whenever they preached, Jesus is alive. So here is, here's the great thing. I was reading in theological books this week, and it says that, and I don't know if I'd really ever focused on it, but that the resurrection was the greatest event that's ever happened in history. You know, I think of the birth, and I love Christmas. I love Christmas, and I love to celebrate Christmas. But you know, unless there had been a resurrection, really, Christmas would have lost its significance because he would not really have been the Son of God, the Savior of the world, the one that is alive forevermore to make intercession for us, who sits at the right hand of God, who's coming back again one of these days to get his church. And so I'm thinking, yeah, that's probably right. It's probably right that the resurrection was the one greatest event that has ever happened in the history of mankind. And because Jesus is alive today, we don't have to fear death. Give me Jesus. Give me Jesus. We don't have to fear the grave. As Christians, yes, we know we're going to die, but it's like, I don't really like, I'm waiting to die. I'm waiting to see Jesus. I'm waiting to see him face to face. That's what I'm waiting. He overcame Satan, and he overcame our sins. He died on the cross to take all of our sins upon him so that when we believe in him, our sins are separated from us as far as the east is from the west. Those two lines will never meet. If you go out into the universe, they will never meet. And because we are in Jesus, we are the righteousness of God. When God the Father looks at us, he does not see our sins. We've all sinned. The Bible said all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. But he sees the righteousness of Christ. So on the cross, there was a great transfer. There was a great trade there. Jesus took our sins and gave us his righteousness. Nice trade. Nice trade. Awesome trade. And therefore, we can say without reservation, without apology this morning, that Jesus Christ is alive. He is the risen Savior. Hallelujah. 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 Oh, praise God. That joy. He is risen. I'm going to, John the Revelator, Jesus appeared to John. And this is at the beginning, in Revelation, and this is what he said to John. And by the way, he was appearing in his glory, so John falls down here when he sees Jesus. And when I saw him, and this is in Jesus in his glory, I fell at his feet as dead. But he laid his right hand on me, saying to me, "Do not be afraid. I am the first and the last. I am he who lives and was dead. And behold, I'm alive forevermore. Amen. And I had the keys of Hades and death." Hades was the place of and death was the situation. And so we don't have to fear death, because to all of those who believe in Jesus, he has the keys. And Satan once had the power of death, but he has it no longer. When Jesus resurrected, sometime in the time that he died and he was resurrected, he went to Satan and said, "Give me the keys. I need them right now." And he got them. He got them. So Jesus Christ is alive. Hallelujah. And as we close this morning, I just want to say, if you have not given him your life, you need to do that. That is the most important thing that anyone can ever do. You know, I have little knickknacks I collect, and I look around sometimes and I say, you know what? One of these days, all these little things that I have, my garage is full of them, okay? Like your garage. I'm not taking these with me. I said, you know, one of these days, what is the most important thing? I'm not going to be able to take what's money in my bank account. I'm not going to be able to take my car or my house. Even my family. Now, my family, most of them are saved and born again. So, yes, I will be reunited with them. But really, I can just take myself. And what's the key to going to heaven? It's Jesus. I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except by me. No one can get to heaven without Jesus Christ. He's the Savior of the world. And I've been able to preach that message and had the privilege of going overseas and preached it to Buddhists and to Hindus and to Muslims and to atheists and to whosoever wills. I mean, to anyone that would listen. I've been able to preach that because Jesus is the Savior of the world. And if you don't know him, I'm going to pray a short prayer. And if this is in your heart, saying, you know, I want to accept Jesus as my personal Savior. I feel the Holy Spirit drawing me today. The Holy Spirit is drawing me today. Then I want you to just say this simple prayer, okay? You just say this very, very simple prayer. Just say, "Dear Lord Jesus, please forgive me of my sins and come into my heart. I now receive you as my Lord and Savior. Thank you for dying for me on the cross. And thank you that you're alive forevermore to walk with me through this life. And I will meet you in heaven above one day, face to face. In your name I pray, Jesus. Amen." If you prayed that simple prayer, whether you're here or whether you're on social media, let me know. And we're going to have an invitation now. And if God has spoken to you, I'm inviting you, or the Lord is inviting you, to come down and say, "I prayed that prayer." And if for some reason, I just felt this in my spirit today, if for some reason you say, "Man, I'm here for the first time. I don't know. I'm just too embarrassed." Now, I encourage you to come down during the invitation. But if you say, "I can't just do that," I want you to go. There's a little room right over here. There's a couple of a couch right over here. I'm going to go there right after the service. And if you say, "I prayed that prayer, but I just didn't feel comfortable coming up today," I'm going to meet you here. I'm going to go over there and look in just a minute after the service. And I want to meet you, and I want to hear what decision you made this morning, okay? Okay? God laid that on my heart. Would you please stand? And if you're going to follow Jesus on this resurrection Easter Sunday morning, you come right now. You come. You come.
I have decided to follow Jesus.
If you need to come, you come right now.
I have decided to follow Jesus. I have decided to follow Jesus. us, no turning back, no turning back. Oh, none go with me.
You need to step out and make a decision.
I still will follow. Though none go with me, I still will follow. Though none go with me, I still will follow. No turning back. No turning back.
You may be seated. Hal's going to have some announcements, but as we get ready to leave here this morning, maybe we can sing one of those choruses again, He Arose or something like that.
Okay.
Can we do that? And remember, if you prayed that prayer this morning and you're here, I want to meet you right over here in this little room right afterwards.
Brother Ben, Brother Levi, what an awesome service. Thank you, guys. You guys, you feel the Spirit here today? You know, the thought occurred to me, like it does Brother Ben. We have, every once in a while I mention it, so we have people of eternal titles. Moses was called the meek servant. Job was called the faithful servant. David is the warrior servant. And this morning we're reminded of Thomas, the doubting servant. I can imagine the four of them sitting in heaven playing canasta. And whoever's on Thomas's team is always going to lose because you have to ask permission. And he's going to say, I doubt it. No, no, no. They're always going to lose. Listen, if you are a visitor today for the very first time, we'd like you to take a moment and fill this card out in front of you and then drop it back there on that table in that offering plate, or just leave it in your chair. We'll pick it up so we get a record of your attendance, and we hope you've been blessed by today's service. We have quite a few visitors here today, but we also have some of our old standby members that haven't been here for a while. So Jan and Dan, we're glad to see you two as well. Jared, it's good to see you as well. People want to shake you guys' hands, so don't run off when we're done. You got your bulletins in front of you. We'll go through this really, really quickly. We have our there is no service tonight, so you can fellowship today with your families. You see our financial summary there. Remember, just be faithful in your tithes. If you have offerings, you don't know what to do with your tax return, we've got some ideas for you. Okay, so just call the church office. Let's see, the new member, Catherine Logan, joined last week. April calendar of events, the big one is next week we have our annual fish fry. Norma has told me that it is a fish and a barbecue chicken meal, full meal. So invite everybody to come back. We're going to have plenty for 150 or 200 people. So just like Brother Ben told us last week, let's invite some more old ladies. Don't call them old ladies.
We fished all last weekend. We caught about 30 bass. We got a lot of bass to eat. The catfish did not bite worth a darn. So we didn't have any catfish, but Walmart does, and we're going to go down there and pick some up. But we do have some bass, so come next week, have some fun, and eat.
Nobody likes you, Levi. Fine. Be that way. I've been trying to fish all springtime long, but my truck has been in waiting to get fixed for like 2.5 months, and my beautiful wife, Myra, says, you're not putting that stuff in my car. So I'm waiting for my truck. Let's see. So anyways, that is next Sunday. So you guys invite your family and your friends, and let's come back for a good fish fry. Saturday, April 23rd, the OUGMA Gospel Music Concert is here at 6:30. April 30th, we're going to do another one, I guess, the very following Saturday. Sunday night series, we're not going to meet again until May 1st when we're doing the Heroes of Faith. We're still doing the favorite hymns. Back there in the back in the foyer, there's a bucket. If you'd like to get a song sung by these guys or us do it as an audience, put it back there, and we're going to get it into the rotation. We got a couple of memory verses. Lonnie put that up there. Why is today already a great day?
This is the day the Lord has made. We will rejoice and be glad.
And because Christ proved it by his own power resurrecting, what can we do through Christ in us?
I can do all things. Christ,
all things. We can endure all things. You guys can even endure my humor.
Change versions on us.
Yes,
there.
Well,
okay.
We did that last week,
oh, okay.
So you weren't here. Yeah. All right, so any other announcements before I close this portion in prayer? Anything else? All right, you guys stand and join me as we close out of here. Heavenly Father, we thank you so much for what you do for us. Father, we thank you for seeing the need for the ultimate sacrifice of your Son. Lord Jesus, we thank you for understanding what was required of you, something beyond the ability for us to completely understand, you knowing every step of the way, every lash, every scourge, every whip, everything that you knew was coming, yet you went through it for us out of love. Salvation is born out of love. We thank you for the evidence that you are alive today. We thank you for what you did for us that bridges the gap for us to get back to heaven. We know that it's through you or no way at all. We pray that you will watch each one of us as we leave here today, safe passage wherever we go, the fellowship with our families and our friends. May we be reminded to include you in our fellowship. In your holy and great name, Jesus, we pray. Amen.
Yeah, that's good.